Good morning, dear students. In last lecture, we have studied in detail about the Lewis method and Bragg's method for X-ray diffraction by crystals. Now, in today's lecture, we will continue with the X-ray diffraction by using powder method. This is the simplest method for studying the X-ray diffraction by crystals, and this method was developed by a scientist named Debye and Scherer in 1916. Till now we have discussed the methods Bragg's method and Lewis method. Those methods suffer from the disadvantage that they require well-formed single crystal for its use. In these methods, we require single crystal for X-ray diffraction, which has to be rotated about a suitable axis so as to get reflection from various planes to get the diffraction pattern. And that was the problem, that we must have a single crystal of a particular compound to get its X-ray diffraction by these methods. And in many compounds, it is very difficult to obtain the single crystals. So in this method, the sample is used in very fine powder form. So that problem was resolved here. To make it easy, the sample was used in very fine powder form. The sample was taken in powdered form in a thin walled glass tube, and no rotation is required this time. In this case, the tube containing the powder that is rotated to ensure that all the crystallites in the powder, they are randomly oriented towards the incident X-ray. Now, what is done, a beam of monochromatic X-ray is focused on the sample and a circular film is placed around the glass tube containing powder. In the powder form, the various crystal planes of different small crystal will be oriented at all possible angles to the beam. And that is the problem resolved here. We will not have to rotate the crystal again and again to get the reflection from various planes. As in this case, we are having sample in the powder form. The crystal planes of different small crystals present in the powder, they will be oriented at all possible angles to the beam. So each set of HKL plane that will produce a diffraction cone originating from the powder. As we are having different planes which are oriented towards the incident beam, each set of planes having Miller indices HKL, each set of HKL planes, there will be various type of HKL planes in the crystal. So each set of HKL plane will produce a diffraction cone originating from the powder. Thus we will get a large number of cone from a different set of planes. Now we are having a circular film placed around this glass tube containing powder. And the incident X-ray beam is incident on this glass tube so that to get reflection from all possible planes. And these reflections from a particular set of HKL plane, they will cut this photographic film in the form of a cone. Each cone will meet this photographic film at two points, producing two arcs at equal distance from the bright center point. As we can see here, at the bright center points, there are two arcs which are cutting the photographic film. These are corresponding to a particular set of HKL planes. These two arcs of a cone, they will be at equal distance from the bright center point. And this bright center point is corresponding to the undiffracted beam. Like this, this is the undiffracted beam and this is the reflected beam. This undiffracted beam here, that is giving a bright center support. Bright center support is here, and we are getting two curved lines here due to the intersection of cone onto this photographic film. Now what we are looking here in this figure, When the incident angle is theta, the angle of reflection from this plane is also theta. So total angle between the incident beam and the reflected beam will be equal to 2 theta. So reflected beam is making an angle of 2 theta with the direction of incident beam. Now how we can determine the interplanar distance between the planes which are producing these curved lines on this photographic film? So how we are indexing or assigning the Miller indices to these planes? Now for this, the distance x of the each line, for example, this is the cone formed by a set of HKL plane. These two curved lines are at a distance x from the central bright spot. Now this distance x of a curved line from the central bright spot, suppose that is denoted by x. This will be half of the distance between the two lines of the same cone. It will be half of the distance of total distance between the two lines of the same cone. So this x distance is here, and suppose the radius of this film, the total photographic film is here, the radius of this film is r. That in that case, the circumference of this photographic film will be equal to 2 pi r, and this total circumference of this film equal to 2 pi r will correspond to the scattering angle of 360 degree, complete circle here. So this circumference of this photographic film, which is of radius r, that will correspond to the scattering angle of 360 degree. So what we can see here, at angle of 2 theta, we are getting a curved line at a distance x. At angle of 2 theta, this distance is x. And at angle of 360 degree, the total photographic film is covered corresponding to this 360 degree angle. So we can write 2 theta by x is equal to 360 by 2 pi r. 2 theta is corresponding to distance x, and this 360 is corresponding to total circumference of this photographic film. So we can say 2 theta by 360 degree is equal to x by 2 pi r. From this equation, we can easily find out the value of d. As we will know the value of theta from here, if we know the value of x from the diffraction pattern, if we know the value of r of the photographic film, radius r of the photographic film, we can easily find out the value of theta from this equation, and knowing theta, the interplanar distance between the planes can be easily calculated. So this is all about the powder method for diffraction of x-rays by crystals. Now next one is the crystal structure of NaCl. How is there the crystal structure of sodium chloride? The X-ray diffraction study of sodium chloride crystal, it has been found that it is having face-centered cubic lattice. In this face-centered cubic lattice, the sodium ions are present at corners, which are denoted by here solid circles. So these sodium plus ions are present at corners as well as at the face centers, whereas the chloride ions are present at the body center as well as edge centers. Now this arrangement can be vice versa also. In place of sodium ion, we can have chloride ion, and in place of chloride ion, we can have sodium plus ions. Now, what we are observing here, every Na plus is surrounded by 6 chloride ion, and each chloride ion is surrounded by 6 Na plus ion. So the coordination number of sodium and chloride ion is 6. Now what are the total number of units of Na plus and chloride ion in one unit cell? In one unit cell, there are total 4 units of Na plus ion and 4 units of chloride ion. So how we can calculate this? Just by simply the contribution of each ion towards a unit cell. For example, contribution from Na plus ion at corner will be equal to 8 into 1 by 8, that is equal to 1. as there are 8 Na plus ion at corner and each ion is contributing 1 by 8 to each unit cell. So we are having 8 into 1 by 8 equal to 1. Similarly, contribution from Na plus ions at face center, that will be equal to 6 faces into contribution per unit cell, and that is equal to 1 by 2. So 6 into 1 by 2, that is equal to 3. There are 6 Na plus ion at 6 faces, and at each face it is shared by 2 unit cell. So contribution per unit cell is 1 by 2. The contribution from Na plus ion at face center is equal to 6 into 1 by 2, and that is equal to 3. So total Na plus ion per unit cell, that is equal to 1 plus 3. 1 from the contribution of corner atoms and 3 from the contribution from Na ions at face center. So total Na plus ion per unit cell, that is equal to 4. Similarly, in case of chloride ions, 1 chloride ion is present at body center and their chloride ions are present at edge centers. There are total 12 edges. So 12 into contribution of each chloride ion per unit cell which is present at edge center, that is equal to 1 by 4. So total contribution from chloride ions present at edge center, that is equal to 3. So total chloride ions per unit cell, that will be equal to 1 plus 3 equal to 4. So we are having 4 units of Na plus ion or 4 units of chloride ion per unit cell. Now determining their coordinates, suppose the Na plus ion, they are present at corner and the origin is considered at these corners. Suppose its coordinates are 0, 0, 0. Now from this coordinate, from this origin, we can find out easily the coordinates of other ions. So by considering the origin at the corner, the coordinate of Na plus ion present at the face center will be 1 by 2, 1 by 2, 0, 0, 1 by 2, 1 by 2, 1 by 2, 0, 1 by 2. We can easily find out from this figure, the Na plus ion present at the face center, they will have coordinates like this, 1 by 2, 1 by 2, 0, one of the coordinate will be 0 and other two coordinates are corresponding to a face. Similarly, coordinates of chloride ion will be 1 by 2, 0, 0, 0, 1 by 2, 0, 0, 0, 1 by 2. And coordinate of chloride ion, which is present at body center, that will be equal to 1 by 2, 1 by 2, and 1 by 2. Now, similar to this sodium chloride, sodium bromide, sodium iodide, they will also possess the face-centered cubic lattice. Now, what about the crystal structure of potassium chloride, KCl? KCl will also have face-centered cubic lattice similar to sodium chloride, in which Na atoms will be replaced by potassium atoms. Though they are having similar structure, but their diffraction pattern will be surprisingly different. You will see the diffraction pattern of KCl is different from the NaCl. Now, what's the reason behind this? This can be explained on the basis of the scattering of X-rays by the electrons in different ions containing different number of electrons. As the X-rays are scattered from electrons and these two compounds NaCl and KCl, they are having different number of electrons. So that's why scattering strength will be different in case of NaCl and KCl. Greater the number of electrons, greater is the scattering strength. Now, the scattered X-rays, or you can say reflected X-rays, they will be interfering with each other. Depending upon the orientation of these ions, reflection may be in phase or out of phase. When they will be in phase, there will be constructive interference take place. When the reflections are out of phase, destructive interference will take place. So in case of NaCl, the total number of electrons in sodium ions is less than that of chloride ions. Therefore, whenever the reflection will be out of phase, the scattering strength of sodium ion and chloride ion, they do not cancel out completely. As you very well know, the waves from positive and negative ion, they are interfering with each other. So when they will be out of phase, the scattering strength of Na plus and chloride ion, they will not cancel out completely. as their scattering strength are different. They are having different number of electrons. In case of KCl, both potassium and chloride ions, they are having same number of electrons. So their scattering strength is equal. So when they will be out of phase, their scattering strength will be completely cancel out each other. So complete cancellation will result into diffraction pattern different from that of the diffraction pattern obtained in case of NaCl. So what you will observe in case of KCl, the powder diffraction pattern is similar to that of primitive cubic unit cell instead of the face-centered cubic unit cell obtained in case of NaCl. The reason being, in this case, the scattering strength of potassium and chloride ion is same because of equal number of electrons. So this is all about the crystal structure of potassium chloride. Next one is the crystal structure of cesium chloride. Cesium chloride is found to have a body-centered cubic lattice. It has two simple cubic lattices, one of cesium ions and other of chloride ion. And these two simple cubic lattices, these are interlocked together to give a pseudo body-centered cubic lattice. So as a result of this, chloride ion, they will occupy the corners and cesium ion will occupy the body center within the cell. So the coordination number of this cesium plus ion as well as that of chloride ion, that will be equal to 8. Each cesium plus ion will be surrounded by 8 chloride ion. Each chloride ion will be surrounded by 8 cesium. So its coordination number of cesium plus ion and chloride ion will be 8. And its unit cell will contain one cesium plus ion and one chloride ion per unit cell. The contribution from chloride ions at corner, that will be equal to 8 into 1 by 8. As there are 8 corners and contribution of each ion is 1 by 8 to a unit cell. So we can calculate here the total contribution of chloride ion at corner, that is equal to 1. Similarly, there is one cesium plus ion is present in the body center, so its contribution is equal to 1. So we are having one cesium and chloride unit per unit cell. This is all about the crystal structure of cesium chloride. Next topic we will continue in next lecture.